Yeah, you're doing a good job.
Does it help a bit?
Huh?
Lemon tea or something help out?
It's lemon tea and honey.
Oh,
Yes, ma'am.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you?
I'm doing good.
Yes, sir.
Right, how about you, Doc?
Good to see you.
You all right?
Yes, sir. I wonder why pressure on my ear, you know, it makes me, well, it's hard to walk to the side and bent over. I do.
God bless you. To our Heavenly Father in heaven, to Pastor Evan, Sister Love, Reverend Harris, Deacon Staff, we can be my brothers and my sisters in Christ Jesus. We're so grateful to God, our Heavenly Father, for allowing us another opportunity to see a resurrected Son. But certainly, Jesus Christ, He's alive. The tomb is empty. He's not there. If you are a child of God, if you have confessed with your mouth the Lord Jesus, if you believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you know exactly where He is because He lives within you. His Spirit dwells within each and every believer. Again, I would like to say Happy Resurrection Sunday to you, and we're going to have a good time in the name of the Lord. Amen. Scripture read for your consideration, reading from Luke's Gospel, chapter 24, rather, chapter 23, beginning with verse 44. And it was about the sixth hour, and there was darkness all over the land until the ninth hour. And the sun was darkened, and the veil of the temple was torn in the midst. And when Jesus had cried with a loud voice, Father, into thy hand I commend my spirit. Yes. And having said this, He gave up the spirit. Let us pray. Right now. Almighty and all-wise God, God, how we love You. Yes. How we thank You. Yes. We thank You for just a few more moments on this side of death. We thank You for a resurrected Savior. Oh, yes. God, we know that He lived. Yes. And because He lived, yes, we live also. Yes. We thank You, God, for the privilege of being able to witness another Resurrection Sunday. Yes, we thank You for the sacrificial death, burial, and resurrection of Your only begotten Son. We pray now, God, and we ask that You would just bless this service in a special way. During the course of this hour, God, help us to reflect back on Calvary, yes, where our Savior hung, bled, suffered, and died for the sins of the world. Yes. We ask Your blessing, Your anointing on these young people as they prepare the program. Yes. We, God, ask God that You would just touch them, allow them to feel Your presence and Your power. Yes, we pray for the preaching as well as the teaching of Your word. Yes. We pray and we ask in Jesus' name that You would just use Pastor Evan in a very special way. And then, God, we ask that You would give these congregants open minds, open hearts, allow them to be receptive of the indwelling of the Holy Spirit so that You might be glorified. We ask and we do thank You. In Jesus' name, and for His sake we pray. Amen. Amen.
28th chapter, the 1st through the 10th verse, the empty tomb. In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulchre. His countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And said unto women, fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified.
He is not here, for he is risen, as he said, come see the place where the Lord lay.
And go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead, and behold, he goeth before you unto Galilee. There shall ye see him. Lo, I have told you.
And they departed quickly from the sepulchre, with Peter and the great shoulders, and he had gone to bring his disciples to the river.
And as they went to tell the disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, all hail. And they came and held him by the feet and worshiped him altogether.
Then said Jesus unto them, be not afraid. Go tell my brethren that they go into Galilee, and there shall they see me. Amen.
Determines faith, so I feel like you're on fire.
And I can make. So we still committed. I don't expect you to see me in a big thing, you can just see me in a little thing.
I know.
I'm so excited today, it's like today and today for the first one of the teams. I was trying to do the CFS meet. Hey, let me just start.
What are you doing?
There's a lot. This is where I always sit.
But we can't think of it.
I know what you're talking about. So how much do you work? 50 hours?
Not one minute.
Okay, 100 minutes. You know your mark, please. But you might have to catch up into like daily meetings or something.
Oh, I like when you're trying to build this stuff. But how did you go get your own money?
I'm not that good at like helping and teaching and stuff. But now just turn that TV down.
Sure.
I'm so sorry, Jesus.
I'm sorry, Jesus.
Anaja, go to your room and watch TV. I'm so sorry.
Bye, Anaja. But, Anaja, do you know how long you've been at my office? Anaja.
Yes.
I want you to go up to her and hit her up the room and tell her all about me.
Amy's my gym, I like the room.
So how would you tell her all about me?
Well, I tell the church you paid to do.
Yeah, how would you do it?
Well, I'm sorry, you probably don't feel comfortable enough to do it.
No, how would you feel comfortable?
Have you ever been in a situation and started to question whether God still loves you? Romans 5:5 tells us that God loves you whether you feel it or not. And his love isn't conditional upon your good actions or holiness. Knowing and trusting that God will never stop loving you means you can let go of your fears because he'll never abandon you. One of the greatest questions of life is, who are you going to trust? My answer is for you, never be afraid to trust an unknown future to a known God. And whether you realize it or not, we need all of this to run the Christian race for our salvation. It's a race with a God, a doctor. Look to it that appears to be registering your word for the Lord and encouraged in Colossians 3:23. We don't work for God's acceptance or to meet his needs. We work because we are already accepted to meet the needs of others. Remember, keep running for God's grace is in you. Jesus, I can't do that.
You can.
I can't.
You can.
I won't.
Next. Thank you. Well, let's see. Trustees go lying, so skill, so absolute kindness. Let's just see how I mean.
Okay, before you even get started, I admit I done some things that weren't so great in my life.
Yes, I see.
But, for example, I cheated on a test one time, but to offset that, I babysat my grandson for free. So that was about to leave out, right? His family.
That's fine now. This way, please. Yes. Step up, please. Not you.
You have been accepted because you are a child of God. Here you are. Welcome, welcome, welcome.
Hey, wait a minute, wait a minute. Her mom is way bigger than mine. That's not fair. Look at your mom.
The Bible lets us know that for grace are you saved by faith, not of works, lest any man should boast.
If
actions to ensure that our egg hunt following service is a success. Thank you. At this time, we will now turn the program over to our Minister of Music so we can continue to go higher in the things of God like songs of Zion, followed by the preached word and giving. And again, I say, thank you, one and all.
Bye.
worship of holy, your wonderful hand, your powerful name. God, we are so grateful for everything that has transpired in this service thus far. The youth ministry, the participation of the congregation, we give you glory right now. And Lord, I pray that your anointing will continue to fall fresh, even on this your servant. For Father, I cannot teach without you. Lord, I ask right now that you would grab hold of me, my mind, my soul, and my spirit. Do not let me go until you are satisfied. Mr. Holy Spirit, make this word real in the hearts of these your people. And God, I will not take any credit for myself. Let this word be convincing, convicting and converting. A word that will lift you up on high. God, I pray that the words of my mouth and that the meditation of my heart would be acceptable in your sight. For you, Father, and you alone are my strength and my redeemer. And all the people of God say amen,
amen.
And amen. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. I want to give you a promise that if you say just a few amens, we will be out of here before 3 o'clock. God made him, speaking of Jesus, who had no sin, to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. May God add a blessing to the readers, the doers, and the keepers of his most holy and precious word. They like the use of the substitute. The substitute. The substitute. Substitute is a very familiar word. It means a person or a thing that was put in place of another or to exchange. Back then it was even a military term when a friend could enlist for military service in the place of a person that had been drafted. An illustration story would be of a man that was called and drafted to go to war. But that man did not want to go. So what he did, he found and paid a substitute that was willing to go to war for him. But the thing that happened was the substitute that he paid died in battle. The substitute was there for him. He was counted as being the man. So in other words,
the substitution from a military standpoint means that one man taking the place of another and answering for him, giving his life to fight and die instead of another. Well, because of the work that our Lord and Savior did on Calvary, we have been bought with the price. We have a new identity. We have a new life, and that is eternal life. But the difference is our substitute did not have to be paid. Our substitute, the Lord Jesus Christ, paid the price for us. Somebody say thank you. Substitution has been going on and been around for a long time. Even in the Bible, it was the basis of the tabernacle offering. That was one that was called the burnt offering. It was called the burnt offering because the smoke rose up to heaven, rose up towards God. It was later turned to be the whole offering. Over in Leviticus chapter 6, verse 22, because when it came to the grain offering, the Bible said that the priest was instructed to burn the whole offering, all of the grain. And then later on in Exodus chapter 29, verses 38 through 42, and you can read these verses later, it was considered to be the continued offering. And the reason it was called a continual offering is because the sinfulness of the nation of Israel, it had to be complete, amen. It had to be continual. It had to be a complete and a continual atonement and consecration. And it was done every morning and every evening. I believe today that we don't take confession as serious as they did in the early Bible days. Oh, but even back then, the animals that they used that were accepted was a bullock, an ox, a sheep, a lamb, a goat, a turtle dove, or a pigeon. And over in Leviticus chapter 1, verse 4, when God told Moses about the burnt offering, he told Moses to lay his hand on the head of the sacrificial offering, and that it shall be accepted instead of the people or the individual that had sinned. And the Bible said it did that to make an atonement. In other words, the sacrifice was there instead of the individual. Oh, but I thank God for Jesus Christ today, who is the true substitute. Because had Chris Evans been back there in those days, it would have taken a whole lot of goats, a whole lot of sheep, a whole lot of lamb, a whole lot of turtle dove, and a whole lot of pigeon to be sacrificed for all the sins that I committed. Somebody can identify with what I'm saying. But thank God for the true substitute who died instead of us. Now, if I make my case just a little bit clearer, over at the Day of Atonement, you find chapter 16, verse 9, during that time, there was two ghosts that were presented before God. The one was Jehovah's Lot, while the other was for the people. One goat was killed, and his blood was sprinkled on the mercy seat. But the other goat were presented alive before God. And the sins of the people was confessed over him by the priest, and it was let go. That's why we get the term scapegoat. One goat was sacrificed, and one goat was made alive by the Lord Jesus Christ. That illustrates to us the blessedness of acceptance of salvation. Christ shed blood for us, Christ was delivered for us, and Christ was raised up for our justification. Romans 4:25 says that he was delivered over to death for our sin and was raised to life for our justification. I'm talking about the substitute. But then there's another example in the Bible that we all are familiar with. Abraham and his son Isaac over on Mount Moriah. In obedience to God's command, Abraham had bound Isaac and placed him upon an altar. And Abraham had his knife raised up, ready to slay his son, until an angel of the Lord called Abraham's name. Abraham said, "Here I am." And the angel said, "Because you have been faithful, because you have shown your love for me, I got another sacrifice." And therefore, that was a ram that was in the thicket. And Abraham took the lamb and offered it up instead of Isaac. And that place was called "The Lord Will Provide." And I came to tell you today that the Lord is still providing. The Lord is still making a way. We have instead of us. We did the sin. Jesus paid the penalty. His was a dying cross, and ours was the crown. Jesus took the cup that should have been ours. That's why the God of Gethsemane, Jesus prayed, Father, if it be thy will, remove this bitter cup from me. Oh, what was in that cup? Your sins was in that cup. My sins were in that cup. But Jesus went ahead and said, nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. And Jesus drained the cup, and the cup is empty now. Because the Bible says in Matthew 27 and 50 that Jesus gave up his spirit. Jesus was truly dead. Make no mistake about it. He was not just unconscious. He was truly dead. He wasn't in a coma. He was truly dead. The Bible afraid of. I know who you're looking for. The one that that are viewing via live stream, you can accept the Lord as your personal Savior also. Perhaps there might be one in this house of God who's not sure about your salvation. The Bible plainly says, if we confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in thy heart that God raised Jesus from the grave, thou shalt be saved. But perhaps there might be one, two, three, or seven that's already saved, but do not have a church home, do not have a local body of believers where you can faith share one with another. We would love to be your local body of believers, where our motto is, we are big enough to serve, but we have room enough to grow. I have finished ministry, but I behoove you, even on this Resurrection Sunday, if the Holy Spirit is moving in you and on you, to make your way down the aisle, to give God your life and give God your hand, do not be tricked by Satan. God bless you. May the Lord keep you in my prayer.
Three.
have a special ordeal this morning to the Huff family. Would you please come forward? To the Huff family, would you please come forward? We're going to have an infant.
Grow in wisdom and in favor with thee.
miss it. The parables of infancy and childhood. Defend her amid the temptation of youth. Lead her in her years of personal accountability to hate that which is evil and choose that which is good, that her portion to you may be forever. We pray that prayer in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. This is from the Shed family. First of all, it says, "You serve the Lord so faithfully." To all the M.B.C. family, everything you do for the Lord matters, and everything you do for others is an expression of His abundant love. You are appreciated. We deeply appreciate all the love, kindness, and support you have shown during this difficult time. We love you, Rev. Shed and family. He also has a handwritten message, if I can find it. Amen. Here it is. To our M.B.C. family, the abundance of love and kindness during our time of loss means the world to us. We call out without hesitation our M.B.C. family and took action. We want to extend our deepest thanks to the youth, the choir members, ushers, deacons, culinary staff, members that attended the viewing, members that attended the funeral service, and members that said prayers. Last but not least, Pastor and Lady Evans, thank you for loving and supporting us. Please accept this love offering. We may have moved away, but we still know where home is. And they have graciously given a check to the church for $500. Now it is time for us to wish God with our gifts. Amen. Don't go by the sense and shed all the things we ain't got to give that. Results of our youthfulness. our youth presentation, that the thing they did this morning, they did it heartily unto the Lord. Everybody of our youth ministry, every individual of our youth ministry, to God be the glory for you. Amen. Father, we thank you for these gifts that has been given. We ask, Father, that you bless those that gave also, that you bless those that had a true desire to give but had it not. We ask, Father, that these blessings will be used for the ongoing of your kingdom work, and that they may be used to be a blessing for your people here on earth, even the Metropolitan Baptist Church in Dallas. And all of God's people say amen.
Amen.
I'd like to remind you all of our Wednesday night at 7 p.m. where we have our Wednesday school, where we faith share and fellowship one with another, and we also do intercessory prayer for the sick, the shut-in, and the bereaved individual. If you have not made up in your mind to join Wednesday evening, please contact Sister Dorothy Clark or Sister Regina Allen, and they will get you zoomed in. So I guess we do that by way of Zoom. You don't even have to come down here on Wednesday evening. You can participate in the comforts of your peaceful home. Amen. Well, y'all ready to go home? Y'all ready to go home? He's not just showing up because of the Resurrection Sunday. His brother has been working, okay? Bless you all.